This will be our 71st exposition, being the 6th chapter, verses 5 through 7. This is a very long chapter, as you may know. Young brother Seth, he quoted this entire chapter to us when he was, well, how old was he at the time? 5? Yeah, 5. He quoted this entire chapter to the fellowship. And we're at the beginning of it, and a lot of notable things to be seen here. Now, you want to note that whenever deity or God or Christ works on earth, it's unique. God never duplicates what somebody else does. This is important to learn this. You don't want to ask Jesus to do something the Red Cross can do.
Yeah.
This is out of order. Mm-hmm. It is out of order. Mm-hmm. He is always unique.
Yeah.
It's a way in which man himself can't work.
Right.
He'll do things that nobody else can do. So man should never try and be creative or innovative in an area where God works. Now, if people obeyed this would destroy contemporary religion. Contemporary Christianity is a gigantic effort to try for men to try and do what only God can do.
That's right.
And it hasn't done too well. We're going to learn that from this text that we're going to be dealing in. When it comes to changing men for the better, that's something God does. It's not something man can do. Man wastes his time in trying to come up with ways to teach people how to do things. It's all a waste of time. This God works with a new creation. He makes something that's totally new, and men who are not part of that new creation cannot give valid information about how the new creation is to live.
Amen.
It just is not possible. When it comes to a powerful message, see, God does his work through a message, not a method.
Yeah,
amen. There's a difference. When it comes to the maintenance of a godly life, men are big on how to maintain this. It's a waste of time. See, all people engaged in this, they could just pack their bags up and go home. It isn't going to work. God has made provision how to maintain godly life. It involves an intercessor within, the Holy Spirit, an intercessor in heaven. See, it involves Christ living in you. And if that doesn't work, it's unworkable. And how it's all of this power is received by grace through faith, not by routine and by discipline. That's not how it comes. Now, in order to prove human incompetence, see, men are they don't believe they're incompetent.
Yeah.
And there are men in the world that are very, very successful in the world. And for them to think of themselves to being incompetent in anything is like unthinkable. But God goes out of his way to do this by telling them to do things that they can't do. Here's an example. Through Moses, he said to Israel, circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no more stiff-necked. All right, there it is. Do you want to do something? Circumcise your heart. Here's another one through the prophet Ezekiel. You want to do something? Cast away from you all of your transgressions, therefore, as which ye have transgressed, and make you a new heart and a new spirit.
Yeah.
There you are.
Yeah.
That's how God challenges people. You think you can do a lot? You think you're smart? Make a new heart for yourself and make a new spirit. See, this is God does this. God challenges you to do something that you can't really do yourself. But it still stands. This thing has got to be done. You've got to end up with a new heart and a new spirit. It's got to happen. If you can't do it, now you're ready for God to do it.
Amen.
I love that. You know, godly people, they long to be able to do the impossible. Oh, that I had the wings of a dove. then would I fly away and be at rest. See? Well, you can't make wings of a dove and fly away and be at rest at yourself. But see, men long for the impossible.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a godly men.
That's right.
Long for the impossible. See, now then that God comes into the picture. When once the heart's persuaded, God is able. When that the heart's persuaded of that, God is able. It transforms the way you live.
Yeah.
Transforms how you approach things that look like they're impossible or unworkable. Now our text will provide us an example of this. John 6, verses 5 through 7. Yeah, I think actually I'm going to go through 5 through 9. Well, here, let me read the text. When Jesus then lifted up his eyes and saw a great company come unto him, he said unto them, unto Philip, he said unto Philip, whence shall we buy bread that these may eat? This he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them that one of them may take a little. Mm-hmm. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, saith unto him, there is a lad here which hath 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many? Now, Jesus has been doing miracles among great multitudes of people and teaching them as well. He's met with some resistance, but showing that the disciples were in an environment on a regular basis where there was a lot of impossible things being done. Some people oppose Jesus, and so as he's wont to do, when opposition against Jesus arises, eventually he just leaves. So he left. He went over the Sea of Galilee to more peaceful environments. Matthew revealed that he did this after he heard about the martyrdom of John the Baptist. That's how tender Jesus was. See, omniscience doesn't make you hard.
That's right.
Amen.
Knowing a lot, you don't lose tenderness when you know a lot. Mm-hmm. Jesus knows everything. He's still very, very tender. So he left the field of controversy and went over the Sea of Galilee. And when the people heard he'd left, they followed him on foot out of the cities. Now, one thing you observe from this, wherever Jesus is ministering, he becomes the primary attraction. And you see this all through the Gospels. If you're familiar with the Gospels, you know this. See, the Passover was at hand. That's the highest day Israel had, the highest feast Israel had. And during this time there, Jesus got the attention of everybody. And the people are aggressive to pursue him on foot. They find out where he's going, they fly, they like flock there. Mark says of this event, and Jesus, when he came out and saw much people, was moved with compassion toward them because they were sheep having not a shepherd, and he began to teach them. And he began to teach them many things. See, the teaching of Jesus is done in the context of compassion. Now I challenge you to find a person who thinks teaching flows from compassion. Like, see if you can find just one person. It'll make you happy if you can find just one person. Compassion is ordinarily not connected with teaching. Men don't connect this with teaching at all. But this is what Jesus did. He had compassion on the multitudes, and he taught them. Now I want to draw attention to our own assembly here. Who is not aware of what we teach here? Yeah, everybody knows that we teach here, because it's public.
That's right.
We don't conceal, we conceal nothing.
That's right.
Nothing's done behind closed doors. This has extended now over a period of 24 years. Our Friday meetings have been attended by nearly 1,000 different people. Not all at the same time. Everybody knew, everybody knows what's happening. The number of things taught here has increased. The number of people doing them has increased. It's seen in our young people, it's seen in our old people, it's seen in the men, it's seen in the women. What we, the validity of what we do here has been demonstrated. And anyone that wants to see it can see it. Mm-hmm. We invite anybody in the world to come and see. Mm-hmm. That's because Jesus is here.
Amen.
Well, I thank God for it.
Yes.
Now, I personally experienced this kind of accelerated teaching for over 56 years. Non-stop. There's never been a single gap for 56 years. I've seen this. I have seen people drop off. I've seen people leave. But I've seen people come. I've seen unlearned people advance. This is proved in the crucible of life. It's proved that what we're doing is, it is true. You can't account for the spiritual growth of the people apart from what's being taught. It's the same thing as in the Bible. I think sometimes we can kind of forget this, and you can get to where you're trying to answer criticism. It doesn't need to be answered. Our answer to the criticism is come and see. That's our answer. See what we teach. See what we do. These are the products of what we do. See how many people have become expressive. See how many people pray. See how many people are devoted. See how consistent their service is, see? Well, that's what people said when they saw Jesus. Now, Jesus lifted up his eyes and he saw this great company coming to him. He's withdrawn with his disciples. He's in a mountain. Now, he sees this multitude of people coming to him. They numbered in the thousands. There were 5,000 men beside women and children. So people say conservative estimates is maybe 20,000 people. This is a mobile city, moving about. Why it'd make history, the newspapers, the NBC would be here if some 20,000 people showed up for anything at the same time. See? This is remarkable. But this is Jesus. This is the drawing power of Jesus. If you can generate an interest in Jesus,
amen.
Not an interest in problem resolution, an interest in Jesus.
Yeah.
If that happens, then these multitudes happen. And Jesus received them because he came to seek and save that which is lost. See, so this is right. This is the kind of thing Jesus can work. Jesus can work with people that are coming to him.
Amen.
They can expect something to be done. When Nicodemus came to Jesus, he received him. When the Samaritans wanted Jesus to stay, he stayed 2 days. See, if you want Jesus, you'll not be disappointed. If you come to Jesus and you want him to teach you, you'll not be disappointed. You will not. The scripture says, the prophecy of Jacob to Judah, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. He doesn't say the people will gather to him, they will be gathered to him.
That's right,
The gathering. God drew the people to him. So in this text, we have a demonstration of the possibilities of God drawing people. You can try and make people come. And there's people that have developed all kind of strategies and how you market yourself on this. But see, this, I'm not for this. Let's be right frank with you. I'm not for, in fact, I'm against this.
Amen.
I'm against religious marketing.
Amen.
I think it's a cover-up for impotence.
Yeah.
But if you get God with you and you've got God's message, not only will people be gathered to you, the right people will be gathered to it. Them shall the gathering of the people, not a people, be. Now this gathering doesn't, of course, catch Jesus unawares, because this is what he came. He came to, if it wasn't for mankind, he wouldn't have come.
Yeah.
This is why he came. So this coming people are going to encourage him and fuel his faith and heart to see these people. Now he says, he sees this multitude, he says to Philip. See, there were more people there. There were all 12 of the disciples were there, plus some others. But he singles out Philip. See? Now, if you're real bashful, you know, you better be careful about getting close to Jesus. He'll call you out.
Yeah.
Now, he will. I'm telling you the truth. He said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people?" He didn't present a strategy. Where should we buy bread for these people? The disciples didn't know this condition was going to introduce itself, so they hadn't made any kind of preparations. But now we're being exposed to how Jesus teaches and leads his disciples. He's going to show you how he works with his people. He doesn't give them a precedent to follow, because he'd never fed a multitude up prior to this point. There'd been no example of him miraculously feeding a multitude. So this is the first time.
Yeah.
First time challenges are generally the best ones.
Yeah.
As we proceed to the record, we'll find that the disciples, knowing that Jesus was compassionate, had already kind of begun thinking about this. Know this about Jesus, he'll put your capacity of thought to the test. He'll say to Moses, "What's that in your hand?" Make him think. When confronted a poor widow with a massive debt, he'll say, "What do you have in your house?" So this question goes further than financial resources, although it includes that. We're now speaking of a supply of bread large enough to feed this multitude. Now, where are we going to find someone that has warehoused this much bread? See, that's another situation. So if you did have enough money, like, who's going to be able to, who's going to be able to supply? Where? He didn't say how. He said, where are we to buy bread for these people?
That's right.
Where is there a person or a place that carries this much bread?
Yeah.
Having enough for few to eat was not enough, they thought. Not even enough for 1,000 or so. That's just what they thought. We still insist that wherever we obtain resources, it has to be enough for everybody to be fed.
Yeah, amen.
Now, this revolutionized church-going Bible studies, this will revolutionize them now. Wherever we go, we expect everyone to be fed. I will not give my ear for a moment to someone who just feeds certain people. They may rank high now on the religious list, but they're way down at the bottom of mine, and I will not listen to them. That's just me. I'm just speaking for myself now. You understand? This is the principle. This is how Jesus operates.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Everybody who's there or nobody.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Now, our text says this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he'd do. Notice he didn't ask how this is going to be done. He said, where are we going to get food? Where can we buy food for this many people? He didn't say, let's at least try and feed the children. Can you see if we can at least the children need to be fed. We can at least feed the children. See, this men would say this.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
It's not what Jesus said. Mm-hmm. He didn't say, let's at least feed the women. They're caring for the children. Let's at least make sure now the women are fed. Or the men, that they're fed so they'll be able to earn the living and so forth. See, this is what's wrong about specialized ministries.
Yeah.
See, they're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
They're wrong. Now, you get in trouble saying this, but see, I can handle the trouble, so I'll say it. They're wrong. This is not how God operates. He doesn't specialize in certain sicknesses. And when he heals a sick, he teaches him at the same time. See? So specialized ministries, this is an invention of men because they don't have enough. They don't have enough to serve God. So they try and do what they think is a valid part. See, what about the feeding of widows? They specialize there. Yeah, they're Christian widows. They're what they did. This is the truth. They used their office well, and they worked themselves out of a job, so to speak. This he said to prove him, test him, try him. One might question, well, why did Jesus test Philip? Didn't he know what was in him already? Well, yeah, Jesus knew what was in man. That is the truth. Yes, Jesus already, he didn't have to have anyone testify to him of man. He knew what was in man. See, he knew their thoughts. But more is involved here than Jesus being informed about Philip's state. Philip had, he wanted Philip to know.
Amen. His goodness.
He wanted us to know.
Yes.
About this. This record's going to go for thousands of years.
Yes.
People are going to read about this incident. And it's going to minister to them.
Amen.
Some people would never have known that Jesus tested people if things like this weren't in the Word of God. He doesn't give Philip any hints. He just asks him, where can we purchase bread for this multitude? Now, God's noted for proving or testing. We, in a sense, kind of take for each other for granted sometimes. And there's nothing wrong with that if you have the right indicators. But God's not that way. He doesn't just take things for granted. When the people one time complained because they didn't have any water, they were delivered through water. Keep in mind, if you've been delivered through water, you ought to at least conclude that God has power over water. But
yeah.
See, they didn't think about that.
That's right.
And here's what's written about them, Exodus 15:25. Moses cried unto the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. And when he had cast it into the water, the waters were made sweet. There he made a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them. All right, so a bad circumstance arises that looks like it's against you. It's a test. This is a test. How are you going to react to this? It's a test. Don't stand up and cry and bawl like a baby and bellyache. This is a test. He tested them there. Got to the waters of Meribah and they were bitter. They couldn't drink them.
Yeah.
Plenty of water, you just couldn't drink it. Well, there's still water like that, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You can't drink. Israel's trek in the wilderness was a test. Here's what it says about it. Deuteronomy 8:2. It was to prove them to know what was in their heart. Deuteronomy 8:2. That's what a trial does.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It finds out what's really in there.
Amen.
What's in your heart. And this is God's manner. Now we're talking about God's manner. And this is Jesus projected God's manner. Years later, there in the time of the judges, God reflected back and he said, I also will not henceforth drive out any from before them of the nations that Joshua left when he died. Joshua didn't drive everybody out.
Uh-huh.
And God says, I'm done. Mm-hmm. I'm done. I'm not going to drive out anymore. Mm. Huh?
Yeah.
You got to be able to identify now with this.
That's right.
That through them, I may prove Israel to these remaining enemies. That I may prove Israel whether they will keep the way of the Lord to walk in it as their fathers did keep it or not, whether they'll do it or not. So, when you were brought into Christ, the remnants of your old nature were left behind.
That's right,
yep. We call it the old man or the flesh, mm-hmm. the natural man. Was left. See, he didn't destroy all.
Yep.
Just like he did with Canaan.
Right.
He didn't drive all the enemies out of Canaan. He left a few there mm-hmm. to test the people.
Yeah.
He didn't take everything out of you that he didn't want.
Mm-hmm.
He forgave all your sin, but he left some little nations there
mm-hmm.
to test you.
That's right.
And prove you. Now, a godly person is thankful for this.
Yeah.
How do you handle the flesh? See, I mean, this is something for you to answer because it's been left to test you.
That's right.
And to try you. A holy man of God, they knew how essential this was to be tested. So the psalmist prayed, "Examine me, O Lord, and prove me."
Yeah.
Here we are. Try my reins in my heart. Well, God will do this. He'll test you. And some of the trouble arises you've experienced. Of course, it's not easy because trouble's not trouble if it's easy, you know.
That's right.
But it's a test. You've got to see it as a test. You can say, all this bad stuff is happening to me. Well, it's a test.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
I'm having these thoughts of it. It's a test.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
God is proving whether you have what's necessary to enter into glory or not.
Mm-hmm.
When Israel complained, they failed the test. The same is true if you complain, you flunked.
Yeah, yeah.
And now you got to wait till the next opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Rolls around. Some of you passed through and you passed the test and you've testified, you know, you've testified openly how you came through the thing. You passed the test.
Yes.
That's how you've got to see it.
Yes.
I passed the test.
Mm-hmm.
This he said to prove him because he knew what he was going to do.
Mm-hmm.
He already knew. Knew what he was intending to do, some of the versions say. He had in mind what he was going to do. He had no doubt about what he himself would do. See, this is something of the divine manner you see about God. God knows what he's going to do.
Yeah.
It's that he wants you to know. See,
yeah.
that's it's not that God doesn't change his plans to change what he's going to do for you and this sort of thing. He already has in his mind what he's going to do. Now, some people, they adopt the whatever will be, attitude.
Yeah,
yeah. Que sera, sera. Corrine Bailey Ray wrote a song by that name.
Mm-hmm.
Que sera, sera. Whatever will be, this is the song,
uh-huh.
One verse. Whatever will be, the future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera, what will be. All right, now every once in a while, you'll hear people, they think in this way.
Yeah,
uh-huh. It's all going to turn out. If you're in Christ Jesus, this is what's going to happen. Whatever will be. See, well, that's not an accurate appraisal. If you look at it from God's viewpoint, yeah, but you've got to see it from your viewpoint. God's going to bring you to the point where he can do in you what he needs to be done. And there's no guarantee that you'll be brought to that point. You are warned. Take heed that an evil heart of unbelief doesn't arise in you in
yeah.
departing from the living God.
That's right.
So you're told
mm-hmm.
there's some liabilities here. I'm not guaranteeing you. I'm going to complete this work unless you abide in me.
Yeah.
That's the proviso, unless you abide in me.
Yeah.
So there's something in the divine manner to be seen in this text. Something that will assist you being delivered from simplistic thinking. You don't want to adopt that sort of a attitude, whatever it will be. See, God, what God intends to do, he tells. God tells men what he's going to do. He announces it. He foretells it by the prophets. He demonstrates it in the ministry of Christ. He expounds it by the apostles. See, so what he's, where he's headed, he tells you where he's going.
That's right.
What he himself would do. Mm-hmm. He tells you. There are some characteristics of the kingdom. The kingdom of God is not in word, but in power.
Yeah.
Kingdom of God is in righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So he gives you some traits so you'll know whether you're in the flow of divine power or not. If you're just stumbling about and falling and tripping over things, they're not in the power. You're off the road.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the trouble is. You're off the road. That's what the trouble is. You can maybe try to explain it and how you feel bad and your health's bad, things working to get you, but you're off the road.
Mm-hmm.
There's been people that have lived through horrendous difficulties but stayed on the road.
Yeah.
See? God knows what he's going to do. But he labors through prophets, through Jesus, through the apostles, through holy men that spake as they are moved by the Holy Spirit. He tells you what he's doing.
Amen.
So that you can spot it.
Yeah.
Sometimes you'll just see it beginning, but oh, it buoys up your heart.
Yeah.
When you see it starting, somebody you see you've made some advancement in it. That's your guarantee. The fact that God spoke on these matters is what makes them discernible. It's just what enables you to see them. He knew what he would do. Now, Paul put it this way in 1 Corinthians 2:9, as it is written, I hath not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed him unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. So there you have, there it's this scoped out. God's got has prepared some things for you.
Mm-hmm.
But through the Holy Spirit and through the message of the gospel, he makes it known to you.
Mm-hmm.
So when he proves you, you can kind of make an accurate assessment of things.
Mm-hmm.
In our text, though Jesus knew what he was going to do, he wanted his disciples to better comprehend.
Yeah.
Because he was going to leave them, see.
Mm-hmm.
They had to have a good recollection. We'll learn that after they had done everything they could do, they were, so far as appearance was concerned, left with an impossible circumstance. They looked for resources. They made a diligent search. They found what was available, and it wasn't good enough. Well, maybe you've experienced that. Maybe you've made a diligent search, and you saw, I found this trait. I thank God for this. Thank God for that. I mean, but I got to have more. This isn't sufficient. See, what is that? That's the result of testing. God will test you so you will know how much or how little you have.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Yeah.
Well, he asked, how are we going to feed this? Where are we going to go to buy bread? So Philip said, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that everyone may take but a little. That's his observation. See, they seemed to sense Jesus wouldn't let this multitude go hungry. They kind of had an intuition there.
Again,
yes.
Before you get too far away from this point, that he himself knew what he would do. In the past, I guess I'd always read it as he knew what Philip would do. But that's Jesus knew what Jesus was going to do.
That's right.
And this, I don't know why it took me so long to realize that, but that sure is comforting that Jesus knows what he's doing.
What he's going to do,
that's
yeah.
right.
What he's going to do. And also, we're told not to despise the day of small beginnings.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes what the Lord is doing can seem like a small beginning, but this fact that it's not a secret, we know to some extent what he's doing. We know enough to be able to say, here am I, send me.
Yeah, amen.
He's told us enough about what he's doing so that we can assert ourselves to be used in that.
Yes.
Because it's hard to enter into something you don't fully understand, the end of which is unclear. But that's not the kind of work we've been given to do.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. And I would add this, that what compounds the problem is people have not been told what God is doing.
Amen.
Precious few Christians really know what God is doing.
Yeah, that's
right. Mm-hmm. So that compounds the problem now. After examining the resources, they found they had 200 penny worth available. The NIV says 8 months' wages, and adds the footnote, 200 denarii. Of course, we don't know any more after reading all that fancy scholarship. We don't know any more than we started with. So the word pennyworth is a compound of word of penny, which was a money denomination in those days. So according to the financial bases as of 2010, 200 pennyworth, the British still use this mode of money. 200 pennyworth is $282. That was as of 2010. All right, now if you boil a cheap bread, that'd be about 282 pounds of bread. Well, now you're talking about 20,000 people. I mean, that's not enough for everybody to have but a crumb. Is not sufficient that they may take a little. That's how much bread they could buy. And then, of course, then they'd have to face, where do I buy it? Who has this much bread available to buy? Mm-hmm. So actually, if they were going to buy bread, this really was enough money to proceed. Mm-hmm. They just didn't see it. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you can start with a little meal and a little oil and live on it for 3.5 years... Or if you can start with a little bottle of oil, mm-hmm. and pay off a massive debt with it. See, this was enough money.
Yeah, yeah.
If that's what we're going to, if Jesus intended to buy bread, mm-hmm. this was enough money to start with.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Really was. Mm-hmm. But he didn't intend to buy bread. According to his understanding, they simply did not have enough money with which to work. What are we going to do? So their suggestion was send them away. Now, some of these disciples had witnessed a miraculous catch of fish. They'd seen God supply a whole bunch of things at one time. They'd witnessed it, but they couldn't connect it with this circumstance. Now, here's the difference between a mature believer and a novice. A mature believer can take the facts that they know and can reason upon them and bring them to bear upon the situation.
Yeah.
Mm. A novice can't do that. Mm-hmm. You can't handle. Mm-hmm. You got to be able to handle the truth. So they couldn't take all the miracles they'd seen, turning the water into wine they'd seen, multiplication of fish they'd seen, but they couldn't connect that with this circumstance here. Can you see that?
Amen.
Mark gives the following report. He answered and said unto them, give ye them to eat. They said unto him, shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat? And Philip then spoke. So Jesus, he just told him, you feed them.
That's right.
You feed them. A real teacher from God has heard God say, feed them.
Uh-huh. Yes.
He sets out to do it, and God empowers him to do it. This is the way the kingdom works, no matter who it is.
That's right.
If God says to elders, feed the flock of God,
mm-hmm.
and they believe what he said,
yeah.
they'll set out to do it, and God will empower them
Amen.
To do it.
Right.
If they don't believe God, we got what we got today. And we got what we got today because people didn't believe God.
Yeah,
people have
yeah.
to make that transition.
Yeah, if you see Jesus for who he really is, his word has power.
That's
he
right.
just empowered them
That's
to feed
right.
the multitude.
Then Andrew's there. See, they begin soliciting. Andrew speaks up. Peter's brother. He said, there's a lad here. Remember, we're talking about thousands of people. There's a lad here which hath five barley loaves and two small fishes. Matthew says, they say unto him, we have here but five loaves and two fishes. He said, bring them hither to me. Mark reports, he said to them, how many loaves have ye? Go and see. And when they knew, they said, five loaves and two fishes. So you put it all together. Jesus said, well, find out what you got. So they went out. How long this took, I don't know. The day was waxing. It was getting toward night already. And they went through this crowd, tried to take an inventory of what have we got to work with here? Yes.
This incident where he says, when you were talking about, see what we have, and see what in the multitudes, what they have, reminds me of God saying to Moses, what's in your hand?
That's right.
Yeah.
And this whole incident is just like, you can't feed a whole multitude.
Yeah, speak
just
up.
With just the provisions that you do have, but when God's behind it, he can make it multiply. And it just reminds me, it's like he's just like saying, okay, just go see what we have and see what God will do in this instance.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, what do you have? That's important to be able to assess that. Now, I don't know how they went about taking this inventory. I mean, that's kind of an interesting thing to think about itself. As I said, this was a mobile city. This was half the size of Joplin.
Yeah.
And you take an inventory and see what they got. And they said, well, we have five loaves and two fish, but what are they among so many?
Yeah.
That's flesh.
That's right.
See, that's flesh.
Yes.
The question wasn't how many, is who's going to handle this bread? What can Jesus do with this bread? That was what the issue was.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Now there you have a little boy. Boy is a lad. The word means little boy. So this was probably a sub-teen boy. A little boy that came to hear Jesus speak. This could not happen in our society. You'd have to make this happen. Churches aren't set up for this kind of thing. In fact, they like to dismiss the little lads. Don't they? Tell me about it. We raised our family, visit churches, and people would object to us having our children in the assembly, even though our children were behaved while theirs weren't. Oh yeah, we've I just doffed my hat to this little boy. Didn't say he was there with his parents. Maybe he was, I don't know, but there's this little lad, this little boy, come to hear Jesus. That's Jesus for you. The doctors of the law, they'd come to hear him, and little boy, he did too. Brought his lunch. He planned to stay, evidently, for a while.
Yeah.
What are they among so many? Now, I don't want to be too critical about the disciples. What are they among so many? That was flesh. Because the faith that was delivered had not been delivered at this point. You got to see this now. The faith once delivered, it hadn't been delivered yet. So you can't expect them to have the faith that is possible after Jesus was enthroned in glory. It had not been delivered. God had not yet given to men to believe like he does now. They believed. When they saw the miracle of the turning water to wine, it says his disciples believed on him, but it was like a preliminary or introductory faith. Yes.
Which means that Jesus is still, even through his disciples, demonstrating the need we have for the great salvation of God.
That's right.
Without denigrating his disciples.
That's right.
That's right.
Because I've thought through this, you know, later on, these disciples, after the true light shine and they receive the Holy Spirit, when they're under the test, they do come through in a way that glorifies God.
That's right.
Yeah, they didn't have, this experience didn't happen after Jesus went there back.
That is the way the people of God are when That's they pass right. through tests. When David faced Goliath, he passed the test. Courage is what came out of his heart.
Yeah.
You know, when Elijah had to face the prophets of Baal, boldness is what came out of his heart. And when that young man saw one of the Jewish men take a foreign wife into the tent, he rose up and marched to the nation. He passed the test.
That's right.
See, and that, because that's the way godly people are. So if God has truly put something in you, when you are in trial and you're walking by faith, that's what's going to come out to the glory of God.
That's right.
Amen.
Yeah, the thing I wanted to see here is that at this time, the kind of faith you have in Christ, it wasn't possessed.
Yeah, yeah.
They had faith, but it was a preliminary faith, and it largely was confined to this world. Mm-hmm. The great men of the Hebrews 11, with the exception of the fathers who longed for a country, they didn't see it, they longed for a country that had foundations, builders, makers, God. But most of the incidents had to do with the world. Mm-hmm. And faith made them adequate. At that time, faith made them adequate for the way they had to live. Yeah. So I don't expect a response from the disciples like they had after. As Brother Ricky pointed out, they didn't respond this way.
That's right.
After Jesus was enthroned. But had they not used the faith they had here and maybe been teachable, then that would have been another matter entirely. You remember that when Jesus rose from the dead and he sent witnesses to the disciples, they believed not.
Yeah.
Made a point. They didn't believe. Jesus once said to his disciples, "Why do you not have faith?"
Yeah.
But he didn't say that after Pentecost.
Yeah.
They did the best. You'll never read of a disciples when Jesus was here of his 12 disobeying him. You'll never read that. They always did what he said, whether they understood it or not. They did what he said. That's a sign of a real disciple, see? The like precious faith with that this is not how it will react. After Jesus returned to heaven, the Holy Spirit was given to men, as I mentioned. They never again reasoned like this. Faith matured with Jesus interceding in heaven. See, it was genuine faith they had, but it wasn't mature yet. And there's a sense in which we're that way, too. We start out, as Brother Ricky pointed out, with the beginning faith. It isn't a doubting faith. It's not that kind of faith. It's that it doesn't see as much. It is a kind of limited vision. But now, in the new covenant, we have a reigning captain of salvation.
Yeah.
And we encourage one another to believe that all things are possible. Mm-hmm. You cannot get in an impossible situation.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot. Not if you're in Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And given the religious climate we're in, see, we've got to keep refurbishing ourselves with this understanding.
Yeah.
If you can believe, all things are possible. See, we've got to refurbish ourselves with this because the religious climate we're in does not promote this.
That's right.
And those that teach the capacity of faith, they're talking about health and wealth. They're talking about things of this world.
Yeah.
But we must bolster one another in this in this respect. See, now we're not talking about having enough bread to feed a multitude. Now we're talking about resisting the devil.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
We're talking about that.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're talking about wrestling against principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world and principalities in high places. We're talking about that.
Yeah, amen.
Now we're talking about laying hold on eternal life. See?
Uh-huh.
Now we're talking about finishing the race set before us. See, now that the stakes are higher now.
Yeah, amen.
Now we're called into more involvement. We're not just feeding the multitude now. Mm-hmm. That may sound like a impossible thing, but what about overcoming the devil? How about that? Man in a pure state couldn't do it.
Yeah.
Not the first time. See? So I rejoice at the power that is laid hold of by faith is fully adequate for where we're at.
Yes.
Like the faith they the disciples available to them was adequate for where they were at. See? But as long as Jesus was on earth, his work, it wasn't limited, but he limited it.
Yeah, that's right.
He didn't work as extensively while he was walking among men as he did since he's been in heaven. Mm-hmm. He's working more extensively. Jesus can take one man and feed Asia.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. To one man.
Amen.
He can do that. So I encourage you to think big. How many are on God's side? That is completely inconsequential. The disciples that fed this multitude were 12 in number.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't call for volunteers, you know.
Yeah.
You take that group of 50, you take that group of 50.
Mm-hmm.
Group of 50 and 20,000 people, and a group of 50, you know, you have a couple hundred groups.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He didn't say, you take that group, you take it. Just 12 men he had charge of doing this. How they did it. That's you. God has given you to have charge of some aspect of his kingdom.
Amen.
That's what a steward is. A steward, we call a steward a vice president. You're in charge of handling one talent, two talents, five talents. Everyone has their responsibility. And in Christ, are fully adequate to do it. I think I'll close there, but and set the stage for the rest of this chapter. We're going to be dealing with this, but what a
Amen.
So you say, I just wish we had more. You know, all right, you feed them.
Yeah.
Any of you have a word you'd like to add? Yeah, Brother Jonathan.
Good exhortation. This is always bring what you got.
Bring what you got.
Boy, he was prepared to stay there for a while.
Yeah.
But
amen.
Benefited many others, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Sister Annie?
I was actually thinking the exact same thing as Brother Jonathan. Never think you have too little to bring. Because he brought what little he had, but left with plenty.
Yes, amen.
Yeah, amen.
Yes, Sister Ada.
You see how Jesus addressed this by opening up dialogue with his disciples. That was a conversation.
That's right. Amen.
Through the conversation, their understanding then could grow while they conversed with Jesus and then beheld what he did.
Yeah.
And we find in ourselves that the Lord, sometimes he'll ask us a question.
Oh, yes.
And really, when he said, where will you buy, where will you go to for this?
Yes.
It's really his word to say,
amen.
Come to the one who's asking you the question.
Amen.
Yeah.
See, we dedicate this to the problem solvers, you know.
Uh-huh.
The faith of the lad is admirable.
Mm-hmm.
The implication there is he gave it willingly. This was all he had.
That's right.
He evidently thought he was going to be there for a while, and so he was the one who was prepared, and the rest weren't.
Yeah.
And yet when it came time, he was called upon to give what he had. It seems as though he gave it willingly, believing that he would be taken.
Yes,
care.
Amen.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hey, I don't doubt he ended up with a lot more to eat than was in his bag.
Yes, amen.
Yes, it's Barb.
I was thinking about this aspect of the capacity of our thought being tested.
Mm-hmm.
I remembered Abraham when he was called upon to offer Isaac, that nothing, no resurrections, nothing like that had been done before, but he reasoned because he knew the promise.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's
God
right.
could even raise him from the dead.
Amen.
He offered him. And so I was considering that whenever the Lord tests the capacity of our own thoughts, our mind, It's because we have the basis of the promise of God and the faith that he's given us
yeah.
that we can be enlarged in that area.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, I was thinking of this first sentence says, when Jesus then lifted up his eyes and saw a great company, I was thinking, you know, because he's the commander, he says, they're right on time. All right, now we can get to work here.
Amen.
Tony? Yes. Now, we know there was a work that the Holy Spirit had to do mm-hmm. when Jesus sent him, when he went yeah. back, ascended back. So the disciples were never deficient anymore when it came to
faith. That's right.
Now, you brought up a good thing. I was thinking that Jesus knew, there's a half a dozen times that Jesus made the comment, why ye of little faith, and, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of the. Now, Jesus knew why they were, but he asked them anyway,
yeah,
and some of them were rebukes, mild rebukes, you know, mm-hmm. but I was thinking, now, what do you think, that there must have been another reason for Jesus bringing that up, that was a teaching aid, do you reckon?
I think so, yes.
That he asked them, that where's your faith at, you know, mm-hmm. but Jesus knew, I mean, a lot of these situations was like this one here.
That's
they
right.
were just maxed out. Yeah. It's yeah. the reason they wouldn't they wouldn't
that's
able to.
Right.
I'm mm-hmm. thinking about the, you know, the when they went up to the Mount of Transfiguration, they came back down and yeah. they were struggling with this, and mm-hmm. Jesus kind of rebuked them. But yeah. see, they were all maxed out and they couldn't have done
that's right.
anything. Mm-hmm. So Jesus, though, he still asked them, "Where's your faith
that's
at?"
Right.
So I thought mm-hmm. maybe this was something some other way.
Well, they had to have some introspection and see they were deficient.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But it doesn't do any good. Your deficiency will work against you unless you know you have the mm-hmm. deficiency.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
When the disciples were trying to figure out how they were going to feed this multitude, they were thinking in terms of the basic need, just bread.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus went further than that, yeah. and he gave them fish too.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Amen.
He wasn't just concerned about getting them
Amen.
Fed and their bellies full, but giving them something that was nutritious
mm-hmm.
and giving them what they really needed. And the Lord, he does that for us too. He doesn't just give us just the bare necessities, but
yeah.
whenever it comes to spiritual food, it's a feast.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always in
abundance. Amen. Amen. You know, there's when you get concerned about something, you should only be concerned about, as far as your activity is concerned, about something you can do something about. If you're not able to do anything about it, then Jesus will, yes, go ahead, brother.
The way I look at this is, when Jesus asks his disciples or others, where's your faith? He does a lot of rhetorical kind of questions. He doesn't say to somebody, you need faith to address this problem in your life. He
mm-hmm.
says, where is your faith?
Mm-hmm.
And that makes you turn
That's
your
right.
thinking around.
Right. That's right.
And you think, oh, yeah,
yeah.
I should be thinking in terms
yeah.
of faith, not
mm-hmm.
how I can fix this myself.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And he does that
yeah.
a lot. And
yes, he does.
Yeah. Amen.
Introspection, yeah. that's exactly right. You'll discover a lot if you look at yourself. You'll discover a lot.
Yeah.
And what I was going to say was that when something happens, you can't personally do anything about it or correct it. Now you, one alternative is you can gripe about it.
Yeah.
You tell how bad it is. Another, if you're sensitive enough, Jesus will ask you, what are you going to do about this?
Yeah, yeah.
What do you got? What do you have that I can work with?
Mm-hmm.
See, all of you have, I know you, see, so all of you have something God can work with.
Mm-hmm.
But it's knowing it that makes the difference.
Yeah, that's right.
It may not seem very significant to you. I mean, how significant is five barley loaves and two small fishes? How significant is that? Don't assess how significant what you have is.
Uh-huh.
Whatever it is, give it to Christ.
That's right. Amen. Amen. I've often thought that the miracle, another miracle, is the fact that there was only, out of all 20,000 people, there's only that to work with. I mean,
right.
nobody else bought any fruit. What are you doing? I mean, we would think that totally irresponsible. You go out into the desert with no food?
Yeah.
What's wrong with you?
They might have eaten it all up early in the morning.
Right. Sure. Yeah, but I mean, it's good to be prepared. But like you said, and like the brother says, God will lead you to a place where your resources will dry up.
Right.
And you will have to come to grips with the fact that He's the one that's got to do this.
Like Paul and Barnabas there, was it Paul and Silas there at the synagogue at Antioch of Pisidia? And it's a lot of unbelief there. And the ruler of the synagogue says, "Have you got a word of exhortation for the people?" Paul had 5 loaves.
Yes, that's right.
2 small fish. So he got up and he gave what he had, and a lot of Gentiles believed. Mm-hmm. The Jews fought it, see? But it's good to carry a little lunch with you. Yes. Wherever you go, carry something with you.
Amen.
That God can use.
Yes.
Anyone else tonight? All right. We'll let Sister Barb come.